We can start now. So, good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us again on a Saturday morning. I'm Pallavi. I'm your host, and my colleague Shreyas is also the co-host here. Today, we have Professor Srikanth Paranjpe speaking on India's education sector issues and concerns. And we have Dr. Arun Viswanathan, the moderator. But before I hand it over to Arun, I'm just going to give you a brief housekeeping rule. So, just bear with me, please. So, just about us, Asian Pathfinders is a knowledge sharing platform where we try to bring scholars, academics, practitioners from the industry or research, research fields together to have these dialogues and discussions, and just having a very informal way to discuss, learn from each other. And we really encourage, I know we currently have a pioneer series, but we do encourage, once our pioneer series is over, for young professionals to come present with us and write to us if you have any topic that you want to talk to us about. So, like I said, the pioneer series, it's been ongoing since last month now. We've had really great speakers, and today also we are honored to have Professor Paranjpe. But upcoming ones are one with N. Sathyamurthy, which is on current state of Indian journalism. So that's going to be very, very interesting, given in the light of whatever has happened in the recent months and weeks. So he, and then after that, we have Dr. Meeran Borwadkar. For the ones who don't know, she was the Commissioner of Police of Pune, and obviously, she's a former IPS officer of Maharashtra cadre, very decorated officer, and she's going to speak on the Indian criminal justice system. So that's going to be another interesting session. So just the community guidelines, I know Shreyas will put it up in the chat, but just to go over it, respect the views of others, but please ask your questions and comments in the chat section. But the most important one is respect intellectual property. Anything that's said here, if you want to quote it in your research, anywhere else, just write to us. We'll be happy to connect you to the speakers and moderators. And obviously, just use parliamentary languages. Don't post defamatory comments, illegal content. And how do you reach us? That's me, Shreyas. And you can just look up Asian Pathfinders on the social media and Facebook, LinkedIn, YouTube, or Twitter. Twitter is Asia Pathfinders, so that's there. So today's session, Arun's going to introduce Professor Paranjpe, but just a brief of about Dr. Arun Viswanathan. He is currently the Associate Professor in Security Studies at the School of National Security Studies at the Central University of Gujarat, which is in Gandhinagar. He has previously been the assistant professor at the Department of Defense and Strategic Studies at the Savitribai Phule Pune University. And he's also served as the assistant professor at the School of Conflict and Security Studies, National Institute of Advanced Studies in Bangalore. And he's also been the assistant director in the National Security Council Secretariat. So over to you, Arun. And I am going to just to introduce sir and take on the session.
Thank you, Pallavi. Thank you so much. Good morning to all of you, all those who have joined us on Facebook, YouTube, and other channels, and on Zoom. Let me begin by thanking you, Shreyas, and the entire Asian Pathfinders team for the opportunity to be part of this pioneer series of Asian Pathfinders lecture by Professor Srikanth Paranjpe. And again, it is nice to see you virtually, Professor, because, and I hope we have a chance to meet in person in not so distant future. I thought we'll start with a quote from Mahatma Gandhi, since we just celebrated his anniversary. And I thought this quote was quite relevant to the topic that we are discussing today. He said, "Education is the realization of the best in man, body, soul, and spirit." And before I introduce Professor Paranjpe and request him to deliver his lecture, I just wanted to make a few points. Obviously, today's lecture is quite timely and is being held in the backdrop of the new Education Policy 2020, which was released by the Union Government. And all of us would have read a lot of analysis and several debates and webinars on the issue. And I don't want to go into the details of that, and that will be touched upon by Professor Paranjpe, who is much more knowledgeable about issues than I can be. But I just wanted to highlight two points. First of all, that it's about 3 decades since the previous policy was released, which was in 1992. And the NEP is based on foundational pillars of access, affordability, equity, equality, and accountability. And this was highlighted in the draft policy as well as in the policy which was released finally. This brings me to the next issue of funding, which is essential for proper access and affordability of education through public supported university system for all, from all sections of society. And the NEP 2020 has set a target of 6% of GDP being spent on education. And one does hope that this is not another target just on paper and this is actually realized, because it is very important for the success and the sustainability of our education system. And this links me up nicely to the next point that I would like to flag. What is this money being spent on is the question that we have to ask. And in the past, we have seen that the emphasis is largely laid on visible or tangible targets, essentially capital expenditure, as these are favored by policymakers and bureaucrats, especially given that they can be easily assessed and quantified in their annual reports and other things for auditors, etc. What this has resulted in is that the money is largely spent on buildings and other associated spending, rather than on, say, teacher training, better books, funding to libraries, which do not have immediate measurable and quantifiable aspect. You can't very easily measure and quantify them. And this is true for across various levels of education in the country, right from the Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan to the higher educational institution during assessment by accrediting agencies like NAC. And the last point that I would like to highlight is the quality versus quantity debate, which has been raging across India's educational system in recent years. We have to measure continuously. All universities, colleges, schools have to measure number of students, number of fellowships, number of publication by students and faculty member. Everything, it seems, needs to be quantified without little or no attention being paid to the quality, which is, I feel, will turn out to be quite counterproductive in the long run. I will stop here and not stand in between you and our distinguished speaker, Professor Paranjpe, who will be delivering his lecture today on the Indian education sector issues and concerns. Professor Paranjpe obviously does not need any introduction to this audience. He has been a wonderful and inspiring teacher and has been a mentor to generations of scholars and students in international relations, security studies, defense studies, political science from across the country. He is currently the adjunct professor in the Department of Defense and Strategic Studies, Savitribai Phule, Pune University. He is also been Fulbright Fellow, postdoctoral research, and at the George Washington University, Washington, D.C. He is currently Research Fellow, Center for Military Studies, Faculty of Military Science, Stellenbosch University, South Africa. He is several publications to his credit, several books like India and South Asia since 1971, and the U.S. Non-Proliferation Policy in Action, South Asia, which was published by Sterling and simultaneously published by the Oriental University Press and the NY Press, New York. The Peace Agenda for Indian Foreign Policy, Strategic Studies, which was published in Marathi, SARC Parliament, Western India, History, Society and Culture, Parliament and the Making of Indian Foreign Policy, a Study of Nuclear Policy. For those who haven't read this, you should definitely read this book, because it's a fascinating study of how foreign policy and the legislative system, how they think of foreign policy and the making of foreign policy, especially on nuclear issues, India's internal security issues and perspective, and several other books and publications. I will not take any more time, and I will request Professor Srikanth Paranjpe to deliver his lecture. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Arun. Long CV. I told you, the only thing we should say is this fellow has been a teacher and still is a teacher. But anyway, I must first thank the Asian Pathfinders, your team basically, for allowing me to talk on something or express my ideas on something which is not in the core area of what I've been working, that is foreign policy, defense studies, strategic studies, etc. I was asked what are the constraints within which I would make this presentation. Let me spell out the constraints, and let me in that sense say that this is what I want to talk of. This is the framework within which I talk of. I'm talking essentially as a teacher, as a parent, as a person who's been associated with school textbook production, writing, making syllabi, producing textbooks at the Maharashtra State Textbook Bureau. I have not been a member of the UGC or any of the high profile committees, I have no intention of talking about the philosophy of education because that is not my area. Essentially, what I would be spelling out is nuts and bolts in terms of what education really means, perhaps more on issues relating to school education, because I consider that more in terms of formative years and critical, and would also talk of college and university and higher education. This is not also a critique of the new education policy. I remember discussing the new education policy quite a bit for quite a few days when we were in the process of the textbook production in the Maharashtra State Education Textbook Bureau, and how to implement some of, because the first the draft had come in and then we had to discuss it, and then how to implement some of the issues that they had. I would agree with what Arun says that there are a number of issues which it has tried to deal with, whether it is dealing with quality, qualitative, quantitative, capital expenditure, its objective of 6% of GDP expenditure, etc. My stake would always be that things come in a package. So there would always be people who would criticize it. There would always be people who would think that it is good. What we tried to do when we were preparing textbooks for the school level, essentially 8th, 9th, 10th, 11th, and 12th, higher secondary, that is. What we tried to do was incorporate some of the issues which are there. For example, activity-based learning. For example, your whole focus should be get students to think, not just memory recall. Issues like, can you give an opinion on one or two of these aspects? These are the kind of exercises we tried to put in there. So the idea was, one need not go into experiential learning, that would probably be in college, but activity-based, that was the idea. But let me spell out, let me go step by step in terms of what I want to say. Take school level, and as I said, that is a formative year, and which is why I'm more concerned about school level education, and right up to perhaps 10th. Fortunately, at the school, students have to learn all subjects. I mean, whether it is science, whether it is humanities, whether it is language. It is not that you create an interdisciplinary character in the student. No, it is essentially you create a multidisciplinary phenomenon exposed to a variety of things, which is the good part of it. Something which unfortunately ends the moment you finish 10th standard. And then you go into different streams, but I'll come to that in a moment. In that aspect of multidisciplinary, what are the concerns which I have, and what are the concerns that some of us tried to address when we were preparing those textbooks? And my experience is essentially Maharashtra-based, except for what I've tried to gain from the NCERT textbooks, but essentially Maharashtra-based, and so bear with me. The idea was, whether it is, again, mainly social sciences and humanities. I would also talk of sciences and the issues there, but the idea is when you're imparting this right from third or fourth standard onwards, and that is what our committees used to do, can we generate a sense of consciousness in the student about certain fundamental Indian values? No. Diversity of Indian culture, for example. The whole perspective that we are a multi-ethnic, a plural nation, a sense of national identity, a sense about cultural sensitivity, concern about environment, ecology, concern about gender. These are the kind of things which we try to incorporate, and this is again part of the NEP also, but this is, these are the kind of things we try to incorporate right from the third and fourth standard level, in a very, in a, perhaps in a very diluted manner, naturally at that level, but these are the things which we try to incorporate in textbooks to create this, this student who eventually will come out of school with certain sense of who he is and what is his role in society. Having said that, awareness of Indian history and culture, awareness of Indian civilization is something which is critical in all of this. Let me give an example to illustrate what I mean, and in a very serious manner, but you can take it lightheaded. Take history, for example. We teach history as ancient, medieval, and modern as a traditional listing. We start with, in India, we start with what? Mohenjo-daro, Harappa, Indus Valley civilization, and then come to, you talk of Ashoka, you talk of Alexander's listings, and all that is ancient. Then we come to medieval from Muhammad of Ghori, Muhammad of Ghazni. From that point, we start medieval, and we come to modern from the Battle of Plassey. If you look at the textbooks, and that is what actually I actually counted the number of words, but that apart, if you look at the textbooks which we have in history, the bulk of Indian history, whether it is ancient, medieval, and modern, covers history north of Narmada. It is bulk, I mean, 60-70% history is that. Rest is, you know, you have phenomenal empires in southern India, whether it is Satavahan, whether it is your Vijayanagar, whether it is Cholas, whether it is Pandyas, your Travancore Empire, all of these, all of them are put together in a small package. We rarely look at Northeast, Ohom. We rarely look at Kashmir pre-Mughal era. What are we trying to create in terms of a sense of Indianness in that student? And that is a concern. Let me share with you this experience. We modified this entire syllabi in the Maharashtra State Book Bureau and tried to balance the whole phenomenon in terms of trying to ensure that, after all, you know, there is only so many limited pages that you do it. We tried to balance the whole phenomenon and said that we must also have history of the entire Indian subcontinent. And we were criticized. Lots of articles came in that you have curtailed the entire history of the Islamic world in India. And the answer was no. It is not curtailing that. It is balancing that with some other things which we are trying to do. So, but that is how it is. But this is only an example. Similarly, the other issue which I've always felt in terms of school level textbook writing and eventually projections. By and large, if you look at textbooks from, say, out of Maharashtra from various states, by and large, you would always have mention of certain notable local regional figures, whether they are social reformers, whether they are military people who have done great in terms of the armed forces, ancient India, whether they are religious leaders or whatever. My concern has always been that, you know, take Maharana Pratap, take Ranjit Singh, take Chhatrapati Shivaji, take Tipu Sultan, or take some of these people around. We tend to make them regional heroes. We tend to put them in a regional framework, when their contribution would definitely be national. Same with social reformers, same with religious leaders, or same with, especially, you know, take Periyar, take Mahatma Phule. These are not regional figures. They have an all-India impact. But we tend to put them in a regional frame of reference, and naturally we are undermining their importance. We are undermining their contribution. Again, this is what we try to do, successfully or otherwise. Indian National Movement, for example. Indian national movement has traditionally been projected as a movement which is essentially non-violent. Fine, that is an important part of the Indian national movement. I have no qualms against it. But there is another dimension to the Indian national movement where people fought for independence. That is almost ignored, which doesn't make sense to me, because that is also to be taught to the students. Or simple things like Chola Empire, which extended right into Southeast Asia, people have not thought about that. Images, identities. When you talk of Indian image, you talk of the Taj Mahal. You don't talk of maybe an Ajanta and Ellora. Identities, images, you don't talk of Sarnath, for example. What is projected as identities? That is where my concern is. That at the school level we are doing, when you're doing this, you need to broad base, you need to ensure that there's a whole perspective in place. But these are some of the issues in social sciences. Sciences, and there have certain problems. And I might be, people might criticize me about it. We teach students physics, chemistry, and whatnot. I've seen some of those textbooks of physics and chemistry and what all is taught and what all is not taught. When we discussed about activity-based learning in terms of what the education policy ought to be, some of the questions which we used to raise in the committees were, students of the 10th standard, do they know how a TV works? Do they know how a light bulb works? Do they know how to change a fuse? Do they know how to change a tube light? I mean, simple things. You have a computer, fine, you use a computer. Now you are more obsessed with how to use a computer. But do you know a variety of things which you can do on it? These are, you know, something like science in everyday life. This is something which most of the students don't know. Acids, what are the acids used for? Again, students are unaware of what to do with that. So science in everyday life, you know, talking of activity based, one of the points which we tried to put in one of our textbooks was, as an activity, students were asked to prepare a first aid kit. What would you put in a first aid kit? And we had a lot of criticism. They said, this is not to be part of school curriculum. I said, that is part of school curriculum. Disaster management is now taught in schools. So part of disaster management is, how do you have a simple first aid kit in your house? What would you put in it? How would you deal with it? These are things which are simple, but these are things which students should really know about. And that is what science in everyday life is all about. Same with mathematics. When we teach them a variety of things and trigonometry and geometry and whatnot, you ask them to make simple calculations. You go to buy vegetables and you ask them to make simple arithmetic calculations. Poor fellow cannot do it. That vegetable vendor does it. If it is 1 kilo is for so 1 kilo rice or 1 kilo whatever sabji is for so much, and two, you get 200 grams, or you want to have 250 grams, how much it would be? You require a calculator for that. That chap sitting there will do it with you. That is activity based. That is science in everyday life. And that is where my argument is, that this is what needs to be looked at. But this is about school, and I can talk more about it. Coming to college, once you go finish from 10th, you suddenly are bifurcated, and your multidisciplinary phenomena, interdisciplinary phenomena is only in theory. See, in India, when we talk of interdisciplinary, we say you have created an interdisciplinary perspective books. What is exactly is done? You have an edited book. I write a chapter in my area, you write a chapter in your area, the third person writes a chapter in that area, and you bring it together and you call it interdisciplinary. That is not interdisciplinary, that is multidisciplinary. Your approach should be interdisciplinary. We have never taught students to have an interdisciplinary approach altogether. You go into arts, you go into commerce, you go into science, you go into technical education or whatever. Now we have started to talk in terms of liberal arts. When we first started to talk in terms of liberal arts, people would criticize it as something of an American fad, that how is it that the student who is learning perhaps to become a doctor, why does he have to learn history? Why does he have to learn sociology or psychology or philosophy? Or why does he have to learn a language? Now we are slowly becoming aware that even if you want to become a doctor or an engineer, you need to learn a little of sociology or philosophy or history. Or even if you want to become a historian eventually, you need to see, archaeology requires a lot of science. That concept of liberal arts is now slowly being accepted in India, but liberal arts colleges are rare, few, very costly. The other problem with liberal arts is you do a liberal arts education and then you go for a job and they'll tell you don't have a traditional degree. You don't have a BA in political science or history or physics or whatever, therefore you have no job, because that structure has not changed. That structure still remains traditional. And therefore, when you're talking of liberal arts, that is what, how, you see, a lot of universities have started created in semester system. They allow what, 25% of the courses to be taken outside your department. Excellent. But look at which courses are taken by the students. They are never outside your faculty. They're, if you're in social science, mental, moral, social sciences, they're within that faculty. You will never find a student who is doing perhaps masters in social science, sociology or history or philosophy or political science, taking a course in chemistry. They'll say you should not do that, even if it is a basic course. You'll not be allowed to do that. So the whole perspective. So when we first tried to implement that in Pune University, that is way back, that was the original idea, that you should be able to take courses across faculties. We started with that, but then again, technical things like timetables and exams and those things come in, and then eventually doesn't gel. But the original idea, when we initiated the semester system and credit system in Pune University, we started it with that idea, and we structured the whole thing originally with that idea. It has never worked. I don't think any university allows that kind of a cross phenomena. Except, as I said, liberal arts universities or some of the private universities who are doing that, and that is where the whole problem comes in. Problem also comes in terms of technical education. See, when India started 10+2, the idea was that after 2, students would go into professional education, technical or otherwise skill education, not necessarily traditional higher education. Higher education was, the perspective was that not everybody has to go, everybody does not have to go for higher education. Everybody does not have to do a master's degree or MPhil degree or a PhD degree. What will you do afterwards? And that is where the problem comes in. You continue to do it and you continue to enter into that, and eventually you end up knowing almost nothing in terms of market value. That's where I come to another aspect. I'm flagging a number of concerns. I have to talk within 30-35 minutes or whatever. Higher education, you come to also research. When you come to research, we've been obsessed with API scores. You require so many points for having a seminar which is recognized in this manner, an article which is recognized by this journal or not recognized by the UGC, or not, it has to be a foreign journal which is recognized and not recognized. Obsession with API has made research a problem. If you allow students to do research on their own and come out with some really good work, whether science or arts or commerce or whatever, you'll perhaps find better research being done. It was being done earlier, but API has, you know, made it very clerical in nature, extremely clerical in nature. And that is because you have to simply tick, say that you have so many points and you have to tick. If you do not have it, that assistant registrar will say you're not qualified or whatever. The decision is not taken by an academic. The decision is taken by an assistant registrar sitting there saying that you don't have that much. I'm tempted to talk about PhD research, but I'm, except for saying that a lot of us are involved in correcting PhD theses, evaluating PhD theses, and guiding them. And we know the problems that exist, and we know how eventually you sometimes have to get students through, pass the students through that this thing. And I would not talk of that. But let me spell out about quality and quantity, and share a small experience which we had. I used to be a joint director and then a director of the Competitive Examination Center in Pune, a special center for scheduled caste and scheduled tribe students. We used to insist that the students who are being admitted, they would have a scholarship and whatnot, they would necessarily come from rural, remote areas who really require an additional input in terms of they being made eligible to appear for the UPSC or the State Services Board examination, etc. What we found was, and that is the policy which we had, you take in a student, the student is there for 1 year, he would sit for a variety of exams. But the principle was, once you're a student of the center, you continue to be a student of the center till you finally get a job somewhere. So you can keep coming to the center, use the facilities, sit in for lectures, whether you are a current student or not, it really doesn't matter. Quantitative evaluation, something which Arun was talking about. The government of Maharashtra created a committee. They said, this year you have taken 40 students. How many went into UPSC? How many of these, how many went into MPSC? How many went into whatever? And the argument was, and they would find that this batch, almost nobody went into those exams. So I got that committee to sit in the class and say that, look at these students who have come in here. Look at them after 1 year. Look at the difference that you see in that student after 1 year, the awareness and the willingness to work that student has. That student would eventually get a job, pass those exams after 2 or 3 years. And that is what we realized. I said, look at the qualitative change that is bringing in the students. Don't tell me about quantity, saying that this year we have so many admitted, nobody has passed. I said, don't look at that. Look at how the student has changed over a period of years and then eventually got a good job. That is critical. That is a qualitative evaluation. Fortunately for me, that committee accepted that recommendation of mine, and they did not pass adverse remarks on our center on that issue. But that is because the committee was willing to listen. But otherwise, it is only quantitative analysis. That MAC reports are all quantitative. You come up with points. There's nothing qualitative about what you're doing under MAC reports. That is what it is. Same with examination patterns. The whole obsession with multiple choice examinations, objective type questions, we have stopped getting students to analyze, to think on their own, make a critical perspective of things, test writing skills or whatever. No, simple things. You ask a student to write a small paragraph about what he thinks on a particular issue. You get a perspective, you get a sense. You ask a student to analyze something, have analytical skills, test presentation skills. How does the student present? Language is immaterial. I have nothing against language. Test your presentation skill. You can do it in whatever language or whatever language you are. Instead of that, if you're only going to have multiple choice examinations, you're not going to test anything. Especially if you're going to have multiple choice examinations for a research student, that is the last thing you should have, because research requires something else. Even if you're having those examinations for employment in a teaching job, that requires something else. Ask that student to stand up and make a presentation. That makes more sense. But that is how, is how it is. And last point, and then I'll stop and I'll open myself for questions because I've taken your 30 minutes. You see, in all of this, my concern has always been, what should the student learn in terms of every stage of that level? You know, for example, that is how we prepared the whole syllabi pattern. We were given a kind of an open-ended phenomena. So we prepared the syllabi right from the fourth, fifth standard to the 10th standard on a continuing basis. The argument is, at the level of the 10th standard, when the student gets out of school, what is the minimum quantum of knowledge that the student should have? Similarly, when I'm looking at 11th and 12th, when a student gets out of the 12th standard, what is the minimum quantum of knowledge that the student is expected to have? What would he be at the end of that higher secondary when he exits? Or what would he or she be at the end of the graduate? He or she becomes a graduate. What is that you expect from that student when you say that you are a graduate and therefore this is the minimum quantum of knowledge, perspectives, your idea? What is it that you have? Syllabus making is something of that kind, and that is how it has to be done. We at least that is what I would claim. We did that very effectively so far as the school level textbook, right up to and especially for political science and defense studies and whatnot. But there are problems. And I'll give you an illustration why I'm saying there are problems. Since I've been teaching defense studies for so many years, I'll give you an illustration from there. Take a course like defense economics. This is taught in the defense studies department. The continuous criticism whenever we were making a syllabi for defense economics has been, why do you have to teach about Indian economy? Why don't you go directly to defense economics? And my answer to that always used to be that unless you understand what Indian economy, fundamentals of Indian economy are, you will never understand what Indian defense economics is. Or if you're looking at even a subject like defense studies, basic concepts like nation, nation state, nationalism, unless you understand these concepts, you will not know what is national security. So this integration that is required, the classic case which has always been is maps. I have been insisting that if you are teaching political science, history, international relations, defense studies, whatever, maps are a core of it all. You cannot teach any of this without maps. And I've been criticized for that. That why do you want so many maps in a textbook? I said, look, I want them whether you like it or not. And you'll have to put them. Awareness that the students need to have about what is around them, what is in India. Whenever we used to talk about the Maharashtra Public Service Commission, I used to tell the student that, look, if you're appearing for a Maharashtra Civil Service exam, you should be able to tell me each district in Maharashtra without looking at the map, where it is located, because you're going to appear for that. If you're appearing for a civil service exemption, the UPSC, you should be able to tell me regions in India, geographical regions, economic regions, states, where exactly are they located? If they are northeastern states, don't tell me Manipur is south or Arunachal Pradesh is north or where it is. Don't mistake about that. That awareness, understanding what is around you, awareness about your country, awareness about your civilization, awareness about history, awareness, all of that is part and parcel of what you are. Whether you are a science student or an art student or a commerce student, it is immaterial. That fundamental awareness has to be there. Unless you have that awareness, you would not be a good citizen. You would not be a good individual for all practical purposes. Even awareness about how to manage conflicts, how to manage the fundamental basics of psychology, basics of philosophy. How do you look at a crisis situation? Every student has a crisis in life. How do you understand that crisis? How do you address it? How do you help yourself? Take help if you want, but how do you go about it? These are things which every person needs to know. And that kind of an education is something which one has to look at. These are nuts and bolts. I mean, this is not a philosophy of education, but these are nuts and bolts and concerns which I've been sharing in while making those textbooks in Maharashtra, and then sharing with a number of my colleagues. Some of you have listened to my rants of this kind for a number of time, but they have stopped there. Open myself for criticism, and I'm quite sure some of you might not agree with what I say, but I'm open for that. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor Baranjpe, for that very fascinating talk. And there are I'm sure all of us have lots of questions and lot of takeaways, and I could not agree more with you on several points actually when you talk about the need for history to be well rounded and history to be actually for the whole of the country rather than for specific parts or specific periods. Second, I also I remember this discussion that I had with a colleague about the 70s and 60s and 70s and 80s, where humanities and social science departments were very, very strong in IITs, and how engineers who used to come out of this institution at that time were more well-rounded, were better sort of not only good engineers, but also well-rounded as individuals with life skills, soft skills. And in your point about liberal arts, we seem to be going back to, so it seems to be coming to full circle in some way. It will take more time, I guess, for the institutional, the systems to adopt that, but I feel that is something which is very, very necessary. And I will, because we have several questions, maybe I'll come back to some more points I have later on. First, we have Dr. Sonam Chuki from Bhutan. She is the curriculum developer in Bhutan. Her question to you is, what is your take on the purpose of education? Should education only serve the market? And you can take down the question. Would you like to me to read out a couple and then you come back, or would you like to take one by one?
Whatever you feel is worth it. You can read out a couple and then...
And this actually, what Dr. Sonam is talking about brings me to a recent ad which comes in IPL and in TV, where you have this coding for young kids. And I always wonder when I see that ad, instead of pursuing sort of just playing, going out and playing and sort of having better imagination, inculcating reading, why are we pushing them to become these sweatshop coders? Essentially, that is what they will become. Because what, and for school kids, what is the need for them to learn coding and spending so much money and effort into that rather than picking up a comic book or picking up some good novel and reading that, or just going out and playing with other friends? So that is just that. The Dr. Sonam's question actually made me recollect that. Another question by Pallavi is, at the level of 10th or 12th itself, students are asked to pick from art, science and commerce. Additionally, if they want to keep options open, they have to take science. A lot of these choices are driven by market value. How can we first change this broad generalization by the system? And second, how do we get students or parents to be open to picking beyond the obvious choices? Maybe we can take these two questions and then come back to more.
Purpose of education to me is to create a very, to create a good human being. That is how I would look at it. A well all-rounded kind of a human being. Something which Arun was saying. Kids in school need to play. Read comics perhaps. Today, everything is so structured. Even when you take them to the playground, you have very well-structured games which they are playing. You'll have a teacher there saying that this is what you have to do. There is no freedom of expression. There is no freedom for creativity of your own. I keep telling some of those kids, you see, I said, when I was young, and when I was in school or whatever, Simple things like, you know, when we used to have a toothpaste box, we used to make a bus out of a toothpaste box. Now you buy a bus ready-made. We used to make a train out of it. I mean, imagination which was possible for a student to, these are small things perhaps, but that is something which is lacking. Everything is so structured. Coding, everything is so structured now. That is not what we should do. Good education. That whole film Three Idiots is about that actually. Good education should make you a good human being. Having said this, I will link it to the second question. We are staying in a very structured phenomenon. if a student wants to do good in terms of a job market or whatever, that student has to make a choice. And that student is structured very early in life, after 12, that you have to take science, because it is only if you take science you can switch on to arts or commerce when you go into the college. But if you have taken arts at 11th and 12th, you cannot take science when you go into college. You have to stick to that. So you are so structured, which is tragic. And therefore students tend to get frustrated over a period of time. See, it is not an accident that so many engineers and doctors go for UPSC eventually. Or so, this is something which I will be criticized for. But let me share this. You do a good technical education from an institute, from IITs or similar institutions. You become whatever computer engineer or whatever mechanical engineer or whatever kind of engineer. You do an MBA, MBA finance, or you do MBA marketing, and eventually you sell soap. Why did you do engineering? You could have gone into marketing right from the beginning. Or, and this is something which I have always wondered, and I might be very wrong. We in India have created a huge human resource of technically skilled, qualified people. We always talk of, you know, a technological base or a human resource that we have. My concern is that human resource is essentially at the level of technical, not scientific. We have created ITIs or from IITs, we have not created scientists. Because to become a scientist, you require flights of imagination. To become a scientist, you require a much more broader perspective. Or, after all, which is why we are good in service sector industry. Service sector industry, the IT industry is a service sector industry. The really good persons who can work as scientists in terms of creating something are very rare, because that is not the aim. And that is where the problem comes in. We've tried to rectify that by creating an institution called ICER, which is a positive development. Because unless you create scientists, you will never become a great power. That is something that is changing. Even your liberal arts education, it is now catching on, but the market requirements are such, and that is where the first question comes back. What is the purpose of education? The market requirements are such that you have to create a marketable person for that person to eventually get a job. My answer to that is, and this is after having sat in a variety of selection committees, a number of places, not just political science or defense studies. If you're really good in your area, you will really get a job, whatever your area. It is always tragic that you find so many applicants coming for an interview and they're being rejected because they are not really good in that area. If you're good in whatever area your work you're doing, I'm quite sure that you will eventually land up with a job. But again, I might be criticized for that. Purpose of education, therefore, is to create a good human being. Follow your whatever you want to do. Go till the end. And then perhaps you'll be able to do something. But that is how it would be.
Arun, you're on mute.
We have another question from Shreyas. Sure. Regarding the curriculum, particularly in social sciences, has it been derived from the need to shape national character driven by political ideology and leadership? That is the question from Shreyas. And we have another question from Nagma Sheikh. The question is there any possibility of selective history curriculum at school level be all inclusive in near future? We have a small question, but short question, I'll not say a small question, from Shreyas. your views on FDI in the education sector. Maybe will this
news about
FDI in the education sector?
FDI,
foreign direct investment.
Okay. FDI, I thought FDI. Political interference. In so far as my experience with the Maharashtra Textbook Bureau is concerned, we had been given a total freedom in structuring the entire syllabus. And these are critical syllabi, history and political science, always controversial. We were told very clearly that the syllabus that you have to prepare and the eventual content and textbook that you have to write, so long as it is academically correct and you are able to defend the academics of it, we will not interfere at all. Political problems is our issue. And believe me, we did that in terms of both political science, history, and defense studies also, but more so political science and history. We did it an independent job. We were critical of all parties wherever necessary. We were willing to talk of a variety of issues across the board. And we stuck to that. There was no political interference, so far as my experience is concerned, in terms of creating syllabi from, and this we did, especially from, since I was associated with it, syllabi making was from 8th to 12th standard. And this I can say there was, we were given an open-ended. They said, academic defense is your problem. Political crisis is our problem. And we had protests from a variety of political parties across the board. And our only answer to that was, read what has been written. And you will find that there is nothing there that's critical to a political party or another political party. So so far as college and university syllabus is concerned, as long as I used to be in the board of studies, my approach was that academics is critical, irrespective of the political parties. I'm not in the board of studies now. I've retired, as you know. Teaching of history in a selective manner, no. The idea of teaching of history is essentially that, see, we go with an idea that history is always interpretative. There is no one truth in history. It is always how you look at it. But even though it is always how you look at a school level, and I'm essentially talking at a school level, you have to tell the students a variety of aspects which exist without hiding them. You don't expect a school level student to really come into an analysis and say, look, this is how I interpret it. That might be done at 10th, 11th or 12th level. But factual information you should be able to impart. So there is no selectivity in that. The essential argument is cover your Indian history in an adequate manner. You also covered global history, world history, because that is also part of your development of awareness. FDI, foreign direct investment. Nothing is wrong with FDI. I mean, if FDI is going to come in, there's nothing wrong. My concern has always been, and this is something which I must spell out, whether it is FDI, whether it is private universities, whether it is whatever, so long as you are able to take care of your core values and core sector in terms of costs, FDI would not be a problem. I mean, there would always be students who are willing to pay more, and then there should always be students who should not be allowed to, should not have to pay more to take the same education. So if it is FDI, that social responsibility is something which that university or that institution would have to ensure in terms of that responsibility. Then there's no problem with FDI. The problem, or there's no problem with private universities. A number of private universities do give fellowships, do give scholarships. But private university, the moment you say private university, very costly. That is the immediate debate. That, if you have to rectify that, make it public. If you have to take this education, this is something which we are willing to do for a needy student. Simply because he is needy and he cannot afford this, he cannot come here, would not be a logic. So FDI per se, I have nothing against it. But so long as that FDI is targeted in this manner, then there would not be a problem.
Thank you. We'll move on to the next questions. Pallavi has a question. EdTech startups, education technological startups have commercialized education with markets dominating what kind of education is imparted or sought. And I think I read a few comments down. She has a follow on, so I'll take both of them together. In my view, the lockdown has ensured that the accessibility of education is reduced for the less fortunate. EdTech startups and technology ensure that only the selective few have access to quality education. Can we take one more question, maybe? Thank you. We have another question from Shivani Agarwal. Hello, sir. Thank you for your lecture. Do you think the rigid and unapproachable education system is also responsible for the high number of student suicides in India?
Okay. Education startups, technology. Let me put a couple of things together. Especially over the last 6 months or so with the pandemic coming in, there's been a lot of focus on digitalization, a lot of focus on computer-based and whatnot. It is true that not everybody has an access to this. It is true that not everybody would be able to access it, especially if you're in a slightly remote area and you do not have the necessary connectivity. Even you do not cannot afford to have certain facilities. Let me again give a different example in this context. In the Balabharati textbooks, the Maharashtra State textbooks, we put what are called QR codes. Our idea is that with every lesson, every chapter, whatever additional material that you might want the student to go into is put into that QR code where you simply have to access it. We know that all students would not be able to access it, but the part of the training is that the teacher should be able to access that. And by and large, teachers have that much of a smartphone capability to access it in terms of getting additional knowledge. This is especially keeping in mind that students in remote areas would not be able to access that. For one, textbooks are made in such a manner that they should by themselves suffice, but this is additional material. The new racket, I don't know whether to use that word, is that you come out with a number of technological solutions and it is a substitute to the old guides. Earlier, for every textbook, you used to have a guide and there would be multiple guides. Now, a student is bogged down with so much of technological phenomena, especially in urban areas, especially in cities, that whatever he learns or she learns in the classroom, there would always be extra lessons that you have to learn in terms of going into this and that and how you do this and how you do that. Too much of a burden, but that is a market. It is up to you to access it or not access it. It is up to you, and perhaps Arun would agree with me, to get your child to go and play rather than sit on a computer and do that. That apart, suicides. Suicides are a matter of frustration. Frustration essentially because you take up a particular line in that structure, and you find that you are misfit in that line. And then can you change it? And if you cannot change it, you get frustrated. You're not doing well. If you want to change it, there's a lot of pressure from your home, from your peers, that why are you changing it? You finish this, eventually do that, and suicide might occur. But suicide is a very different issue. My point is, frustrations are generated if you end up in a kind of activity which is not of your liking. Frustrations are generated if you don't get good marks in the examination. I would rather not talk more about it, but let me add. Where students frustrated earlier maybe 15, 20 years ago, where you as kids frustrated, and the answer might be, yes, everybody is frustrated during school education or whatever. Did you all commit suicides? And the answer would be no. Then why has the suicide rate suddenly increased among school children and college children? And the answer would not be simply frustration, and there would be, have to be other answers, to which I'm not an expert, I would not talk about it. But the rate of suicides in the context of examinations and pressure of examinations is there. Pressure was there on you who are in your 30s, in your 20s, in your 40s or 50s or whatever, when you were in school. Perhaps the manner in which that pressure was tackled was different. The support structure that you had was different. The support structure which the students today have is different, or they do not have. But that is a specialized area, and I would rather not venture into that.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor Paranjpe. I just had two points to add to your answer. Sure. One was about what Shivani said, and I believe you are very correct in terms of comparing earlier. And I think it's also about this very much of peer pressure to get a job, and you are always constantly comparing yourself with your peers, or your family is pressure. So always remember that one is unique. Each one of us is unique. We will always find something which we like, and hopefully also make a career out of it. And if one is able to make a career out of something that one likes to do, that is very, very nice thing to happen. And remember that one can always reach out to your friends, to your teachers, to your mentors, and talk to them. Share your problems mm-hmm. with them. And that is always very important. And that goes out for all students, because many a time you feel that I cannot share this with my teachers, with my school or college psychologist or my mentor. That is not the case. People are willing to listen, but you have to maybe take that first difficult step. And second to what Pallavi's question and your answer to that was, I also thought, thinking about this entire lockdown and this move to digital education or online education, as I might say, there is always this whole thing of the lack or the lack of access to social capital. Because I have seen many of my students who are first generation learners who have, apart from the technical, technological problems, that is, they live in remote areas, so they are not able to access the internet or have very good internet. They are not very well versed with using these tools. And that comes from the fact that we all learn from our peers, from our family members, from our relatives. And there was an interesting report I was reading some months back in India, a survey of schools and children in schools. And they found out that people coming from certain disadvantaged communities, because they don't have anybody else in their family who actually has gone to school or owns a smartphone or a laptop, they find it all the more difficult to adopt to these techniques when it is introduced in their schools or in their colleges. So I think there is this social capital aspect of it, in addition to this whole technological or technical aspect also one has to keep in mind when we are trying to address these challenges and issues. Because technical, technological part is one aspect of it which we need to bridge, but there is also this social aspect to it, community aspect to it, which is also very important for us as educators to think about and remain cognizant of. With this small...
You are very right, especially about awareness of how to use things. If you are new, especially first generation learners, it is very difficult. I mean, my question is, when I first started to use computers, everything to me was black magic. I mean, Google was black magic. When I first, my first mobile, my son forced me to buy a first mobile. He started with a simple sentence. He said, "You don't understand anything. I mean, you have to use this. If not for you, for me." It is essentially a matter of mindset. It is essentially a matter of changing mindsets. And changing mindsets is not always easy. especially if you're a first generation learner, if you're new to it, there is always a fear of this new adaptability. And what you are saying and what Pallavi is concerned is very true. You're not simply having a mobile in your hand. It is a whole fear of something new and how do you really use it. This generation is far more adept than me. So, thank you.
Thank you. If it is fine, we can take a couple of questions which are there and then maybe.
No problem.
Thank you. We have one question again from Nagma Sheikh. Please share your insights on non-formal education methodology, whether it would be suitable for the Indian education system. Another question from Kapil Patil. You talked about the need for greater interdisciplinary approach in research and pedagogy. On the contrary, we do see very silo-based approach among established universities and departments. How to bring in mindset change, and to what extent NEP would be able to achieve that objective?
Nirma, non-formal education, it is important. I would never underrate non-formal education because especially non-formal education is important where you do not have formal schooling structures or whatever. But along with non-formal education, you also require a support of a formal system of education. You cannot do away with that. But you cannot, I will never say that non-formal education is bad. It is in any country like India, where access to schools, access to material in terms of teaching material, teaching aids or whatever is not there, non-formal education will always be important. In fact, I would encourage it. At some point, one has to go into formal education also, but I would definitely encourage it. Interdisciplinary silos, yes, there are silos. See, every university has something called an interdisciplinary center or a department, which is one department or a center which is the most neglected of all the centers. You go and you say you want to do a PhD in PhD on a particular topic and you want to register in the interdisciplinary center, they'll say, no, there is no such thing. You have to take two guides, one from one subject, one from another subject, or a third from another subject. As I said, our mindset is not interdisciplinary. Our mindset is multidisciplinary. And if you have to change that, you have to change the very perspective of how you're going to broad-base your approach. See, you cannot have interdisciplinary if your job market requires you to have a degree in a specific discipline. If I have taken a degree in an interdisciplinary kind of a program, where do I apply for a job? Except for the private sector perhaps. But in the private sector, where do I go? In a university system or in a formal government university system, I must either be an MA in history or political science or physics or chemistry to get a job, or MSc or whatever to get a job. An interdisciplinary degree will not give me a job. So unless that structure changes, it works both ways. You have to have change from below, but you also have to have a change from above. And I'm not very sure how much change NEP has brought in that. From what I understand, that has not really been tackled in the real sense. Your approach is not interdisciplinary. That is my concern. Your approach should be interdisciplinary. We in India, we are all multidisciplinary. We are in silos. That is my concern. In simple examples, I give you an example of a defense economics course. Or I studied economics and therefore I can talk about it. But people will say, well, economics is something that we don't want here, because then the Board of Studies of Economics will say you're entering into our territory. Same with geopolitics, same with political sociology. I mean, take a course like political sociology. Who owns it? Sociology department or the political science department? There will always be a problem there. Women's studies is interdisciplinary. Gender studies. But again, in gender studies also look at the way in which things operate. you, there is always a kind of a sense that what area do I belong to? Gender studies by its very existence is interdisciplinary. But that is not the mainstream, unfortunately.
Very true. If with your permission, I'll take a last round of questions because generated a lot of debate and I don't want to take the chance away from them. Thank you so much for your indulgence, sir. We have, I can see, three questions. And with that, I'll use the chair's prerogative and stop the session. First is from Samir Patil. How do we ensure greater interaction between academia and the policy making apparatus? Second question, set of two questions from Ashutosh Shastri. Question on student apprenticeships for students between age 12 to 16. How to mingle them with regular education and what is required to make it socially more acceptable? He cites the German system, the German case, which has enabled hands-on entrepreneurs. He also adds a need to destigmatize apprenticeship-based learning from the formal education system. We are struggling with this in the UK too, and wondering what Germany did was right. Is there an Indian experience you could share, please? We have another question from Professor Sonam Chuki. How can education sector, schools and university partner with industry to make them learning experiential, applicable and fun? Do you foresee value of education, and if AI and robots replace labor in society and market 10 years down the line? And the final question from Shravan Vyudagiri. How can we improve public education system in India? The $1 million question. So I think that is a good question to end with.
Okay. Let me start with policy level and academia. We in India do not have a structured phenomena in terms of how academia can influence policy. Whatever is done is mostly in an informal manner, where some of you have been working in research institutions or think tanks, where reports which you write for think tanks or reports which you write for that are perhaps taken up. It is also possible that you write reports for political parties. I've done that for quite some time at one earlier. That you write for political parties, they discuss it. Eventually, they might use it or not use it. There's no guarantee whether it will be used or not, but inputs are taken. And my experience with parliamentarians is, and this is a very broad experience, we tend to laugh at our parliamentarians, but my experience is that parliamentarians are sensitive and are willing to take inputs from people if you are willing to give them pointed inputs. They are not interested in reading 20-page research articles. Give them pointed inputs and they will take it. Understand that you don't expect the entire 500 people sitting in the Lok Sabha to be specialists in everything. You might have maybe 10 or 15 people working in areas of agriculture, maybe 10 or 15 in education, maybe 10 or 15 in industry or foreign policy or whatever. Target them and they will be able to accept what you have, what you're doing. It helps. And they're open for that. My experience with parliamentarians has been very positive. Forget the public image of what is being projected. They are open to these inputs, and I think that is a very positive sign. Don't expect that now that you've given an input, it has to be part of policy. No, it is an input. Look at it as an input. The same with the bureaucracy. You are giving an input. Don't expect it will immediately be policy. No. That will eventually be percolated into some kind of a policy. But we do not have a formal structure, fine. But we have these informal channels through which one can cushion your ideas into that. And I'm quite sure some of you, especially working in think tanks, are already doing it. So that is there. Student apprenticeship. Every professional college usually ask you to do a summer job with some industry. I know for sure that engineering, architecture, pharmacy, all of them ask you to do some job, take an internship, give a certificate. How well you do that is entirely up to you. If you do well, perhaps the industry might be interested in you. Internship is a very positive thing, and one must look at it in a positive manner. I know this for sure, that the majority of the students only take a certificate of internship because that is required as part of your completion of credits or grades or whatever. Nothing is actually done, which then it doesn't make sense. You have not learned anything on hand, on the job kind of a thing. That is precisely what happens when you're talking of an interaction with the university system or education system and the industry. Most universities have now tried to create centers where that collaboration takes place. Problem with industries, and this is a problem which I've been told by a number of industrial units across, whether it is engineering, IT or whatever. Problem is that university system of education does not prepare you for the kind of work required in that industry. That is where our syllabus is a problem. So if you, even for journalism, you come out with a journalism degree and then the newspaper will again quote you and ask you to go through a course for journalism. Why? Because their requirements are specific. Unless you target your education, that is where internships come in. That is where internships become important. Unless you target your syllabi, which is why I said activity-based, experiential learning is something that comes here. You target your phenomena in this manner, automatically it will work. In any case, we have institutions working, Institute of Science, for example, or we have IITs who have collaborated with research with the government departments. That is there. It is only how seriously it is done and implemented by university systems and not by simply IITs and Institute of Science or such institutes. Unfortunately, they are more in the forefront. Universities are still on the back foot so far as that kind of an interaction is concerned, but that is now changing, and I hope that is changing for the better. Robotics, I do not know. With whatever robotics or whatever happens, you cannot eliminate the human dimension in any organization. And human dimension is not just HR. Human dimension comes everywhere. You cannot eliminate that. That you simply have machines to work for you does not mean that the human labor has become redundant. Take a very old example. See, when the railways started computerization for reservation ticketing system, now you have everything on a computer in railways. There used to be a huge hue and cry saying that, you know, all those clerks sitting on the railway counters giving you railway tickets, what happened to them? What did the railways do? They trained them. And they did the same work which they were doing on the counter, except that they were doing it on the computer. So you're basically upgrading skills of people. You're giving them different skill sets, because unless you train, and regular upgrading of your skills is necessary across the board. Even we have this what are called orientation programs and refresher courses, which are run in most cases in a very stupid manner, but that is a different thing. The whole idea of refresher courses and orientation programs is that it is a continuous upgradation of your knowledge. You are learning something. I, every day find that I'm learning something new. Whether I'm sitting in the Maharashtra textbook bureau and learning something new from the school teachers who are going to tell me a lot of things, or otherwise. So learning never ends. Whether you are in a factory or whether you are in a teaching profession, skill sets, you have to upgrade your skill sets. And public education system. Public education system definitely needs to be strengthened. How do you do that? $1 million question, I haven't said. See, one of the things which, and again, I will talk mainly about the school level public education system. Students are willing to learn. We, as part of the process with which I was involved, we were able to talk to a number of students across the board. every time a new textbook came in, students would respond very positively because they were learning something new. What is required, and this is a complaint which the teachers would have, is they require to upgrade their own knowledge. And that upgradation can be done by taking regular courses, refresher courses, orientation courses. That needs to be done. And that needs to be done in a more systematic manner. If the teacher gets upgraded in what the new syllabus is or not new courses, automatically it goes down. And for that, teacher training has to be taken a little more seriously than what it is taken. Again, quantification of teacher training is what is being done. What is required is qualitative teacher training, which is to be done. It is not that you have spent so much. You know, our whole policy is money spent and work done. But what work has been done with that money spent? Nobody knows. So qualitatively, one has to go into teacher training. If we have good teacher training, public education would definitely improve. The public education problem is not with the students. Even remote area students are interested in learning something new. As I said, fortunately, because of this work which I did with the school textbooks, we were able to get people from all across Maharashtra. And the whole idea of creating any kind of a board, any kind of a subject committee is that people from every district come in, from variety of regional areas come in. And they come in basically as participants to add into what we are doing and tell us that, look, this is the problem, this is how we can address it. And at all points, the problem at addressing part has always been inculcating whatever has been changed, whatever is new in terms of teacher training to the teacher concerned. That is a gap. If that gap is resolved, perhaps it will be better. Funding, I'm not very sure funding is a problem. Funds are there. It is only how you use them. Which is why I said, money spent is work done. That is our philosophy. We should change that.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor Paranjpe, for that very, very fascinating talk. And I can see from the comments and the fact that we overshot our time by almost more than 20 minutes that
no problem.
People are very much interested and engaged with the entire lecture. I'll now hand it over to Pallavi for the final remarks from the team. And thank you again for taking the time and speaking to us, sir. And as for me, I would like to thank the Asian Pathfinders team, Shreyas, Pallavi, and the entire team for the opportunity to moderate this. I, for one, learned a lot from the talk and from the discussions and the questions. Thank you. Over to you, Pallavi.
Before Pallavi, you talk, let me thank all of you, the organizers, and also those who asked me very pointed questions. And it was worth it. As I said, it is always a learning experience, and it is always helpful. But again, thank all of you for this opportunity. Pallavi.
Thank you so much, sir. I think first and foremost, thank you, Arun, for this amazing moderation, because you ensured that the session flow remains and the discussion stays. As you said, very fascinating and engaging. And thank you for the participants. Obviously, it's been our experience always that our participants always come up with amazing and questions which are very thought-provoking. So I think this session was no different. But I think, sir, really, really final words, thank you to you. I think I learned so much, as Arun said. I learned a lot, and I was nodding, and you can see the video later. I will be nodding, and I'm like, I could agree with so much, right? Being a student of the Indian education system, we all have these experiences that we've shared. So thank you so much for this. I also texted Shreyas saying, learning from you must be very, very fascinating as a teacher. So thank you so much.
Thank you
everyone for joining us. So hope to see you next week. The discussion is on the current state of Indian journalism. The link is there in the chat, but we'll obviously be putting it online. So thank you everyone for joining us again today, and have a great weekend.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Shreyas. Pallavi, bye.
Thank you, Pallavi. Thank you, everybody. Bye-bye.
Thank you, everyone. Bye. Take care.